Vaeira. Vayidaber Elokim al Moshe. Elokim spoke to Moshe. The appellation is Elokim, which is the attribute of justice. Vayomer Elo Vanei Hashem. So Rashi explains it as we just said. Dibir ito mishpot, had spoken to him within a context of justice. Al shehikshu ledaber v'lom alom hiros lom azeh, because he spoke in a certain, with a certain harshness when he posed the question to Hashem, why are you bringing this evil upon the Jewish people? Why did you send me to be the agent? Meaning what Moshe was saying, that if I'm the Redeemer, my coming to Egypt should have lightened the bondage, but rather than becoming less intense, it became more intense. The question was an inappropriate question. Therefore, it's Vayidaber Elokim al Moshe. And Hashem says to Moshe, Ani Hashem, what you think is justice, that's Rachmim. Ani Hashem. So over here, one of the approaches which the Or HaChaim HaKodesh explains, cites the Midrash, Ki HaRishon Mehapchim Midas HaRachmim Yisadim. The evil, they overturn the attribute of Rachmim, mercy, to the attribute of justice. V'atzmu Sh'omer HaKosuv Kan, Ki Gam Midas HaRachmim Hiskimu Lasos Dim Mitzrim. He learns differently than Rashi. V'yidaber Elokim, it's Elokim. Zeshir HaKosuf Ani Hashem. Shukinu Lidin. Ani Modiach Hokimir Sadin Hu Bishem Havayo. Shigam HaRachmim Nebcho Alei Lidin. Meaning that we find by the destruction of Sodom that the appellation used is Yudkei Vovkei, which is always the attribute of mercy. I mean, the level of destruction that God destroyed Sodom. We're speaking about a cosmic destruction. There's no trace of their existence. This is Yud Kei Vav Kei. This is the attribute of mercy. So the way we explained it was that even the attribute of mercy was in agreement with the attribute of justice that they should not exist. That was the level of evil that they represented. So therefore, that's Yud Kei Vav Kei. V'yomer Elokim Ani Hashem. Even the Hashem, even the Yudke Vovke, even the attribute of mercy concurs with the attribute of justice that Egypt has to be destroyed. The plagues have to be brought upon them because of the behavior, what they did to the Klal Yisrael, the bondage, and the way they persecuted them and killed them and enslaved them, unforgivable. Gamas Nakas Bnei Yisrael Shamati, I heard the outcries of the Jewish people, how they're enslaving them, and how they're applying the bondage. Ani Hashem, that's Hashem. The Midas HaDin, but that's Rachmim. Even the attribute of mercy concurs with the attribute of justice. This is what has to be done. They have to be destroyed. Over here, the Sephorno explains, Ani Hashem, you know, we say that even a person believes that God is the creator, he created existence. What about maintaining existence? That existence continues from moment to moment. Does God maintain existence? Of course, you believe that. But within which appellation is that contained? Which name of God is that? God is a creator. Kel Shakai. God's power is unlimited as may be. He's able to reign in on, to bring about an existence which is exact. Ani Hashem. So over here the Sivarno says, Mekayim HaMetzius. Not only did I will existence to come into existence, I maintain existence. Lo Mamtziu B'Levod. It's not only I brought it into being, Aval gam mekaymo, I maintain it. Shein linimtzos shum yeshus v'kiyum. Nothing exists that exists has any essence or ongoing existence. Zulosi shani mashpi alim. It's only because I continuously will that it should exist. That's why it exists. Something doesn't exist because it existed a moment ago. It exists because God continuously wills its existence. It's an ongoing process. Ka'omro, as it says in Nehemia, Ba'ato mechayis kulam. You continue enliven. So therefore, nothing exists in existence without my will. So let's understand something. One of the 13 tenets of Jewish faith is God knows our actions and God knows our thoughts. It's one of the 13 animamins, attributes of belief. God knows machshvos b'nei odom, masa b'nei odom u'machshvosam, their actions and their thoughts. But you understand, if God doesn't know one's actions or one's thoughts, how could one of the principles, tenets of Jewish belief is reward and punishment. If God is not aware of what we do or we don't do, could we spare reward and punishment? And even when we do something, we have various levels of transgressions or various levels of fulfillment of commandments. A person can do something inadvertent, transgress, deliberate, defiant. That's all based on intent. If God is not aware of our thought process, how does he evaluate, how does he pass judgment regarding the seriousness of the transgression? And what about in the positive? A person does a mitzvah. You do it with an ulterior motive. You do it for the sake of the mitzvah. And the various levels of doing a mitzvah, one does it as a result of reverence. One does it many levels. There are endless levels. But if all these levels are determined by one's thought process, and God is not aware of one's thought process, this automatically infringes on the belief of reward and punishment. Therefore, they're linked. One is a direct outgrowth of the other. Because God is aware of man's actions and man's thoughts, therefore, we talk about reward and punishment. There's no action which he's not aware of. There's no thought that he's not aware of. There's nothing which is concealed from his eye. Therefore, we could talk about full value for one's behavior, negative and positive. But how is God aware of our thoughts? Because Ani Hashem. It's not only God brought existence into existence. Every moment of the process of existence, it exists because God wills it at this moment. This is what the Sephardim says. Shein l'mtzos shum yeshus v'kim zulosi ma'shen yesh mashpi aleim. Nothing that exists has any essence of existence unless I maintain it and I continuously influence it to function as it functions. So what's the basis for thought? There's chemical activity in the brain. That chemical activity in the brain that allows the thought process, who wills that process? Who maintains that process? That's God. So therefore, it is impossible that a thought that we have, he's not directly aware of that, because he himself is directly involved allowing that thought process to come about. So there's nothing that God's not in touch with. It once said, we say in the Amidah, the Shmon Esrei, Mechalkel Chaim Bechesed, Mechaim Esim Berachmim Rabim. God sustains life with chesed, with kindness, Mechaim Esim, and he resurrects the dead, Berachmim Rabim, with great mercy. Now we speak, Somech Noflim, Rofei Cholim, supports the fallen, heals the sick, and so on and so forth. What do we speak in both extremes? Let's speak about Mechaim Esim, Berachmim Rabim, Somech Noflim, Rofei Cholim, Matir Asurim, Mechaim Esim. Let's speak about Mechaim Esim later. But immediately, we contrast, he's Mechalkel Chaim Bechesed, Mechaim Esim, Berachmim Rabim. He sustains life with chesed, resurrects the dead with great mercy. And then we speak about the other aspects of life. Why don't we first speak about life? God sustains life with mercy. Examples, supports the fallen, heals the sick, frees the imprisoned, so on and so forth. What do we speak about? Two contrasts, which are at both extremes. Life, death, resurrecting the dead. With this, we're able to understand it. Why do we live from moment to moment? Is it because we were alive a moment ago? And because your health was in its proper state a moment, that's why you continue to live in the next moment. You live from moment to moment because God wills every moment you should exist. So for all intents and purposes, every moment of existence is a new moment of existence. If God would cease willing your existence from one moment to the next, it's not that you're not alive. You don't exist. Existence doesn't exist. It becomes, we go back pre-existence. So we speak about Mechalkel Chaim Bechesed. He wills, he sustains life with Chesed. That's the ongoing process. He wills life. Let's say a person died 3,000 years ago, and now he's resurrected. How is he resurrected? Well, the way he's resurrected is no different than the way he originally man came into existence. If man is ex nihilo, didn't exist, and he became into existence, so he came into existence from nothing. So if he's nothing, so how did he come in? Because God willed, and he provided the energy for man to manifest himself into a human being, into an intelligent speaking species who has choice. That's how man came about. So from moment to moment, why does man function in that capacity? Because he functioned a moment ago. Because God continuously wills that same process that brought him to existence the first moment. So as the Shefa, the influence which brought that about initially is a continuous influence. Therefore it continues. So let's say now we have our hiatus of 3,000 years. Man decomposes to dust. Now God says it's time to resurrect that person. So what does God do? God wills that existence. So willing that existence is what? Is no different than willing a person's existence from moment to moment. Just as if he would cease to will your existence from one moment to the next, you would not exist. So now that we have a hiatus, because God ceased to will that person's existence for 3,000 years, now God wants him to be a fully functioning person. He wills that same influence that he should will fully. Mechalkel Chaim Bechesed and Mechaim Yisim Rachamim is real, it's the same process. As God sustains the living through Chesed, identically, he resurrects the dead. It's the exact same process. It's the rooted in the appellation of Ani Hashem. Not only did I bring things into creation, I maintain every moment creation exists. It's Ani B'chayas Kulam, as he cites the verse from Nehemiah. I give life to all of them. There's no aspect of existence that exists. It's only because God provides that the basis for its existence. So Mechalkel Chaim Bechesed and Mechaim Esim Rachmim Rabim, although we're speaking about life in its fullest sense, and we speak about death where it's totally decomposition to dust, but factually there's no difference. Bringing it back, that's Mechalkel Chaim Bechesed. This is the appellation on the Hashem. And this is what Paro didn't understand. The Ramban writes, in the beginning of the portion, that we find, Hashem says, I appear to the Ovasai Kedoshim, their holy patriarch, Mikhail Shakai. Shmi Hashem lo nadati lehem. Name, Yudke Vovke. So Rashi says, meaning I didn't perform those level of miracles for them. But there were miracles. Avram defeated the four kings, the four mightiest kings of the world. Yitzchak, in a famine year, planted a planting. The yield was 100 times the normal yield of a regular year. So the famine year, even more so. So we find there are miracles. So the Ramban says, Ki nir lovas b'shem hazeh shuminatzeach marochos shemayim. Velasus imam gedisim gedolim shlo nizbatim mina golem. the miracles that God provided for the holy patriarchs, for the Avos, they were great miracles. How do you defeat the four mightiest kings? How in a famine year do you have such a yield, 100 times of normal yield? Tremendous miracles. But he did not change nature. It was still a famine year. The Yitzchok, he performed the miracle. The world is the same world. The world hasn't changed. When we speak about the plagues, all water turned to blood. The whole world was a different world. Fire and hail come down, destroy Egypt. And or the locust. This is a change. This is not a detail. This is not a slight change. Everything is in order except this a slight change for one individual. This is a global impact. This level, that's a different, that's Ani Hashem. As he says, Berov podo osam mimavis. In famine, he redeemed them from starvation. Milchoma, in war, midecherev. He redeemed them from the sword. How does one individual, handful of people, fight the four mightiest kings that defeated the five kings? He redeemed them from the sword. Veloslem oshev chovod choltova. That was personal. They had enormous wealth. Yaakov's wealth. Yitzchok's wealth. Tremendous wealth. But that's the individual. V'heim k'chol ayudim sheb'Torah b'rochus close. He says something beautiful now. He says, it's like all with the Torah forecasts. If you follow my ways, you will have blessing. If you transgress, God forbid, there'll be curse. Now he says something fundamental. Ki lo savo al odom tova b'schar mitzvah. We're physical beings. We live in a physical world. How, if one does a mitzvah, how does that engender blessing in the physical? You did. The value of a mitzvah is its innate spirituality. You understand? The world to come, that has relevance to the world to come. Why does it engender something in this world? It has no relevance to this world. You plant the seed germinates, it grows. You cultivate a field. Whatever you do, you plant the tree, you raise animals. Okay, all that's in the physical. But a person does a mitzvah, how does that somehow bring about a material blessing? Or a person goes and transgresses. A transgression is a breach of the spiritual world. It's not the physical world. So why does it manifest itself, punishment in this world? Whether it's illness, whether it's impoverishment, whatever it may be. As he says, Orob onish aveira, rak b'masanes, that's all miracle. On a natural level, a person does a mitzvah, there should be no change in the physical world. One transgresses sins, regardless of what it is, there should be no change for the negative in this world. It's a miracle. God is altering nature. In truth, it has no relevance to the material world, to the physical world. V'myunach odom letivo lemazolo. If God would leave things based on his nature and just under which star he's born, lo yusifu b'masa v'dover lo yikru mimenu. Your good actions will not add to your account in this world and will not detract from your existence. Your life will be a continuum of the way it's meant to be, unrelated to your behavior. Avoschar kol ha-Torah v'onshu ha-bodom hazeh. But the Torah does speak about reward and punishment in this world. There is one, not only the world to come. Ha-kol nisim, it's all miraculous. Fame the story, it's concealed miracles. He's saying something profound. It's all concealed. The person who, the observer, who's not aware of it, thinks that's the way it is. The people are wealthy, people are impoverished. People are thrive, people fail. People live, people die, people suffer. That's not part of the material existence. Has nothing to do with it. People don't understand. God is intervening in nature and altering nature. That within nature, it seems to be, you don't have a healthy constitution. There was a malfunction in your physicality. Therefore, the person had a heart attack. There was some kind of gene. And because of that, the person has a certain whatever, ailment, certain disease, or certain condition. Nothing. This is this. Because the person did not behave properly, And Midas Adin says he has to be punished. Part of punishment manifests itself in this existence. It's a ness. It's actually altering, it's an alteration of nature, except because it happens multiple times, people attribute it to nature. That's natural. But factually, it's not natural. He says that's a concealed miracle. God is intervening and interfering with the function of existence to bring about reward and punishment for the spiritual. When you succeed spiritually, you fail, God forbid, spiritually. That's what it is. Therefore, the Torah has to speak so lengthily about the reward and punishment in this world, because it's something which really has no relevance to this world. If you follow my ways, you'll have bounty. The rains will come at their time, so on and so. Rain should always come at their times. We have seasons. And sometimes out of the ordinary, both out of the ordinary is also natural. Things happen every once in a while differently. You have good years, you have bad years. Really, it should be a constant. It should be a continuum of whatever it may be. But the Torah says you could have changes. If you behave properly, or you don't misbehave. But that's spiritual. What does spiritual have to do with material? That's ness, except we don't see it as ness, because it's called a concealed miracle. So God doesn't allow us, or mankind, to see it as that. To see it as that, you have to have already, you have to see through the veil of concealment. That's seeing God's hand in nature. We say, Marabu Masech Hashem. Marabus Masech Hashem. Tremendous wisdom God created. So that's only saying God created existence with divine wisdom. What about his involvement in existence? That's something else. That's what we call divine providence. Hashkocha protis. That's another level. Hashkocha protis, that it manifests itself in the physical, that's a nes nisr, that's a concealed miracle, as the Ramban is explaining. There's a famous Rashi which cites Medrash, where Moshe Rabbeinu, Hashem says to Moshe, cites the Gemara. Sh'omer Moshe Lom Hereosa. Moshe says to Hashem, why did you bring this evil upon the Jewish people? Woe to those who are lost and no longer found. He said, I should bemoan the fact of the death of the patriarchs. Many times I revealed to myself to them with the appellation of Kel Shakai, which is a certain appellation of God. He never asked me, what's your name? You're asking me all kinds of questions. When Sori Imenu passed away, he had no burial location. He spent a tremendous amount of money to purchase this burial plot. They came and they contested the wells which he dug. He had to purchase a piece of property when he came back to Canaan. Lohir Achmosa, they did not question my attributes. Vato Amarto Lame Rosa. And you go and ask me, why do you bring such evil on the people? So this is Chaval al the Abdul Lomishtachin. Woe to those who are lost. You see, and I revealed to you so much more. But those who I revealed less, they didn't ask questions. Therefore, it's woe to me that they're no longer here. We can't find those kinds of people any longer. Over here, the Mishnah Tchuma. So what did, when Moshe asked the question, Lomei Rosh Lomazeh Lomazeh Shlachtoni, why bring evil on the people? Why did you send me as the agent? So what does God say to Moshe Rabbeinu? God says to Moshe Rabbeinu, Atotire, now you will see. Asher es leparo, you will see what I'll do to Paro. Ki biyot chazoka Yishaltim, with a powerful hand he will send them out. Ubiyat chazok, and as a result of my powerful hand, Yigoshim Yatzo, they'll be driven from the land. So Rashi himself says, Hirharta alvidosai, because you question my attributes. Lo kavrom, hu yitzok, lefichoch ato tira. Ha'osil faro tira, what's going to happen to Paro, you will see. You will witness the redemption from Egypt. Ulo osil lemalche shiva umos, kishaviyim loritz. But to see the destruction of the seven nations of Canaan, when I will bring them to the land, you will not witness that. Meaning you will not enter into the land. Okay? So over here, the commentary on the Medrash, it's called Anaf Yosef, asks, the Medrash says, you will not see the conquering of 31 kings, not the seven nations, 31 kings in Canaan. So the obvious question is, it's written specifically, explicitly in Torah, why did Moshe not go into the land? Because he struck the rock. And God says, you did not believe in me. I told you to speak to the rock, and you struck the rock. And because you struck the rock, and you did not sanctify my name as you had the ability to, you will not go into the land. So it's explicit to her, why did he not go into the land? Because he struck the rock, rather than speaking to the rock. The mashma, osachetoy mivini sholoretz. This is the question the Marsho asks. Marsho is the commentator on the Gemara. It seems to be, it's not because of the question he asked in Egypt, but rather because he struck the rock. So the Marsha answers, Tvari Yoda Moshe Shenigza Olov Shalikonis Loritz. He understood it was decreed he should not enter into the land. Avul Choshev Moshe Efshel Vatal Agzer B'Tfilo. He thought through prayer he'd be able to nullify the decree. Why? Shloy Obos Agzer Shvuv. Because when God issued the decree, it was not with us. God didn't swear. It wasn't associated with a promise. I swear you will not go into the... God did not say, I swear. Avol, he says, however, Migzeres me meriva, but when he struck the rock, God says, I swear you will not go into the land. Because you had the ability to sanctify my name and you did not. Therefore, the decree of striking the rock, that cannot be nullified. With all the greatest level of tefillah, as it says, Veschanan el Hashem, Moshe supplicated God endless tefillos. God says, I don't want to hear about it. Because since God issued that decree, it was accompanied with an oath, it cannot be annulled. This, Atotire, there's no mention that it was accompanied with an oath. As a result of that, Moshe believed it could be annulled. That's how the Marsha explains it. Okay? So I was thinking, there's a Maral, the Gvuras Hashem. He cites a Medrash on this, on Chaval al the Abdul Mishkakin, where God says, woe to me that those are lost and are no longer found, referring to the Avos HaKadosh, Avraham Yitzchak Yaakov. So Hashem says, Ushem shlo hiru achem yidosai, just as they did not question my attributes, Gamani shamati is nakas bnei Yisrael. That's why I listen to the outcries of the Jewish people. Kloma avo gav shisro shebosedo lo yukshev. The members of the Jewish people of that generation, they were far from being kosher Jews, meaning in terms of the behavior. Lo hoyu ruim ligoil. In terms of their record, they did not deserve to be redeemed. However, lo adakteik achamaseim. I will not be exacting regarding their actions. Why? Kishem shlo diktgu heimachrim masai. Just as the Avos HaKadoshim, I said things which are very questionable. Here I said one thing, and yet, on a superficial level, it seems to be I didn't carry through, but yet they did not question me. They accepted it, face value. We have no questions. So they weren't exacting regarding my words. So, based on the principle of measure for measure, mida keneged mida, although their children's behavior record is far from perfect, I will not scrutinize their record. I will not be exacting on their record. And despite the fact that they're not worthy of redemption, I will redeem them. So why will we redeem from Egypt, although of our personal lack of worthiness? Mida keneged Mida. As the patriarchs did not question me and weren't exacting, although within a human context, it seemed to be God is chas v'sholem, is not carrying through with his word. Therefore, measure for measure, I will not be exacting on their record. I will not scrutinize the record. I will not even really evaluate the record. It's mida keneged mida. That's the chaval al abdim, because do you know what the value of this is? You know, simply, if you read the story, why did we leave Egypt? After so many years, after being 210 years in Egypt, because God promised the Avraham Avinu, your children will be strangers in a land which is not theirs, they will be afflicted, they will be enslaved and afflicted, so many years, then they will go out for great wealth. They can be redeemed. Yeah, but the question is, but we're not worthy. We had to be given certain mitzvos. We were given Milo and Korban Pesach. We, as it says, as Yecheskel says, we were Erev Ve'erya. We were naked. We were devoid of spirituality. We had to have some spiritual worthiness to leave Egypt. So he gave us the mitzvah of Milo and the mitzvah of Korban Pesach, the Paschal lamb. We were mispossessed with the Moich. We had the Dam Mila and the Dam Pesach, and that merit. We said other things. They didn't change their names, their language, their dress, their attire was a Jewish. But you understand that? So what is it? But it's far from perfect. Very far from perfect. He'd say, but you know why? Because he promised Abram. But with this midrash, it's much more than he promised Abram. It's true. With all the promises in the world, if the patriarchs themselves were exacting with God, God says, but factually, we have to deal with the record. The record itself does not allow them to merit redemption. But just as you, the patriarchs, and these are your children, you were not medaktik achamasai, you were not exacting regarding my words and what I said and where I carried through, I will not be exacting on their record. It's a mida keneged mida. This is the morale. Okay? So I was thinking, to answer the Marsha's question, Moshe Rabbeinu is exacting on God. Moshe says, here I'm the Redeemer. Things were meant to get less intense. They become more intense. So what does Hashem say to Moshe? You're not like the patriarchs. Woe to the patriarchs that we can't find those kinds of people anymore. And because of their level of not questioning, therefore the children merited redemption. I will not scrutinize their record. But Moshe, you are scrutinizing, which is inappropriate. You should have been similar to the Ovos HaKadoshim. Because he asked the question, evidently you scrutinized the records. You are medaktik acham yadosai. You're exacting. So therefore, atatira, I will be exacting after your behavior. Once Hashem is exacting after his behavior, this is not a punishment now. For asking the question is not the punishment. You ask the question. You have a right to ask the question. Although it's a question which is going to carry a heavy price. But because you asked the question, based on the principle of measure for measure, as you're exacting, I'll be exacting your record. So what happens now when you strike the rock? I'll be exacting. I said, speak, don't strike. So once you assume a certain posture of exactness, I'll use that same posture on you of exactness. That's the mida keneged mida. So why did Moshe not go into Israel, into Eretz Yisrael? You had the ability to sanctify me, and you did not. If you would have spoken to the rock, you would have sanctified me. You did not. But you understand, but God is rachmim, is flexibility. Why does God have to be so exacting? You know why God has to be so exacting? Because God measures everybody with his own measuring rod. Just as you measured me, you evaluated me by asking the question, Lomei Reoso, and not like the Ovos HaKadoshim, who were not Medakti B'masai, Atotira. Now you will see this redemption, the future redemption. But why won't you see the future redemption? Not because you asked the question, because you struck the rock, but the evaluation of striking the rock will be evaluated on an exact standard. And if it's not an exact standard, you will not go into the land. So therefore, it's not a question. Based on this principle, Chofetz Chaim, in his work Avos Chesed, Loving Kindness, writes, "Vini bemes kol odom Every human being wants that God should deal with him within the context of the attribute of chesed, loving kindness, and rachmin, mercy. But it's all based on what's appropriate, what you're deserving of. Do you do? The way a person conducts himself, his behavior in this world, he activates forces that he should be dealt with in this world. He says, "Im darkol esnagim anoshim midas achesed rachmim." A person deals with others with kindness, with mercy, compassion. Humaorea kenegdul malas midas rachmim. He's activating God's rachmim, attribute of mercy. Umerachim Hashem ala olam bishvilo. God will have mercy on the world on his behalf. Because you acted mercifully, therefore I will have mercy on the world. Al Kain quotes a verse in Proverbs, "Mipri piyish tisbabitno." From the fruits of one's mouth, your stump, you will be sated. When a person needs mercy, Hashem will provide mercy. As you are merciful for others, God says, "I will mercy." This is the principle of Mida Kenegan Mida. So over here he writes, he concludes. He says, when a person is judged, a person is judged as tzaddik because the majority of his actions are positive, are meritorious. Russia, the majority negative. But if God is exacting the person's behavior, his record, you could take the majority positive and whittle down to be a minority. And you could take the majority which is negative and whittle down to be a minority. How? Here's an example. Person goes and he does mitzvos. And this person has lived a life, he was never vater, he was never willing to look away, he always demanded exactly what he deserves. Never forgiving, always exacting. Hashem says, "You did a mitzvah. Did you do the mitzvah perfectly?" It's far, far from perfect. You know something? It's worth 2%. Another person who lived his life willing to forgive, givingness, chesed, rachmim, although he could make a claim, he was willing to forego the claim. Hashem says, "You know something, you're not that exacting. I will not be exacting. You put on tefillin, you score a 99. But it wasn't lishma. It doesn't make a difference. Because God, based on the principle of mida keneged mida, measure for measure, that's nearly perfect. So if that is the yardstick, evaluation mechanism to evaluate his record, the majority is positive. But the other person, where he's exacting in his relationships with people, I want my pound of flesh. I want everything that's coming to me." God says, "I want everything that's coming to me also." So God forbid, person is in serious trouble when God evaluates his record. The reason why the Ovos HaKadoshim, he said, "Lo diktu achamasai," because they weren't exacting regarding how I interacted with them. Therefore, though their children are not worthy of redemption, because their record is so flawed and so far from perfect, therefore they will merit redemption. Moshe, that's not Moshe. You questioned my attributes. You were exacting. You're exacting. I will be exacting. Therefore, as a result of that, when he struck the rock, God took an oath. Even with tefillah, this cannot be changed. He said, "It's mida keneged mida." Moshe Rabbeinu, as the Redeemer, he proved himself. Irrefutably performed miracles. He came, took his staff, threw it on the ground, turned to a snake. He took water, he put his hand in his chest, came a leper. And then it returned to a natural state. Then he took water, poured it on the ground, and as it touched the ground, it turned to blood. So these are the signs, and he said pokut pokarati. That was the code word. That was part of the Mesorah from Yaakov and from Yosef. Then when they hear these words, that's a confirmation that he's truly the Redeemer. So there was no question he's the Redeemer. And initially, there was a stop. There was a work stoppage. What did Paro do? Withdrew the straw subsidy. But he demanded the same quota. It became overbearing. Hashem says, after Moshe says, Lomai Rosh Lomazeh, why are you making it so difficult for them? Why are they suffering such evil? God says, tell them. And he shares with him the four expressions of redemption. And I want you to tell them exactly how it's going to manifest itself and unfold from one level to another. And Moshe does. They did not listen to Moshe because they were short-winded and because of the overwhelming hard work. They didn't have a capacity to what? To pay attention to what he had to say. We have our priorities. We're being tortured. We're being killed unless we meet the quotas. We understand you're the Goel. We understand you're the Redeemer. But, you know, right now we've got to attend to what we have to attend to. Because of the level of pain and suffering and distraction, they couldn't fully reflect on the value of what he was telling them. That's the simple understanding. Like very often, we say words, we know what we're saying, but we're so preoccupied with something which is on our minds, we can't focus. But we know what the words were saying, but to be able to, your feelings should be involved in what we're saying. We're not able to because of what we have on our mind. It's so pressing. Over here, the Aruch Chaim HaKadosh says, what does it mean they were not able to listen to Moshe Mikotzer Ruach? They had a limited spirit. They did not have a broad spirit. Ulai kitzat shaloyim b'nei Torah. Lo shomu. Because they were not b'nei Torah. They didn't study Torah yet. They were pagans. Ulazei yikra kotzer ruach. The Torah broadens a person's heart, broadens your emotion. Meaning, everybody has various levels of capacity. Certain people, they have phenomenal level of capacity, depth and breadth. And when they see something of value, of true value, it actually resonates within them. Of course, they are able to internalize fully what they're experiencing, what they hear, what they see. Other people, it's what we call, they're shut down. Intellectually, they understand what you're saying. It's like the person says, unfortunately, Rabbi, I get it, but if you get it, what's the but? There's no but. The answer is because it doesn't resonate. It's something which is abstract. God is the creator. Nothing goes unseen. Reward and punishment. Doesn't resonate. There's no capacity to process that. What gives a person the broadness of heart, the capacity to internalize it, that it's intertwined and intermingled in every aspect of your being? That's the study of Torah itself. Torah goes and broadens a person's heart, his emotion, his feelings, that you're able to relate and truly appreciate despite everything else. That's what Torah. The Jews would not be the Torah. They didn't have the Torah. Therefore, they had difficulty. They couldn't process it. We hear the words. We understand what you're saying. But we have quotas we have to fulfill. But this is endlessly greater. Greater value. It's worth the pain. It's interesting. I was just thinking. We read in the portion of spiritual contamination, says, Zosa Torah, Odom Kiyomus Bo'em. This is the Torah, man who dies in a tent. What does it mean? This is the Torah, when a man dies in a tent. So we explain, so the Gemara tells us, Chazal tells us, that Eda Torah Niknes El Misha Memes Atzmo Leo. Torah can only be acquired by a person who's willing to die for it. You're willing to forego all your physical comforts, that person who's willing to forgo all his physicality for the sake of Torah, he will be able to process it, to acquire it. You'll be able to be the repository for Torah. But if you're not willing to sacrifice for it, to die for it, to compromise on your own physicality for the sake of it, you're not going to be able to process it properly, you're not going to be able to be the repository for it, to retain it. Why? What's broadness of heart? Only the person that's will, that sacrifices. When you, it's not enough just to study Torah. As he says, they weren't b'nei Torah. If a person goes and he sacrifices, that means what? When you sat, what are you doing? You're spiritualizing your physicality. For the sake of what? For the sake of the ultimate. We say Talmud Torah keneged kulam. The Vilna Gaon writes that one word of Torah, Talmud Torah doesn't mean you sit and study for an hour. That hour is the equivalent of all the mitzvos. Talmud Torah keneged kulam. Every word of Torah is the equivalent of all 613 precepts of the Torah, positive, negative. That is the innate spirituality of the Torah. So if a person studies Torah, and you study it on a qualitative level, lishma, and you're willing to sacrifice, to compromise all the physical amenities for that, what are you doing? You're spiritualizing your essence. You become spiritualized. So if that is the case, it's similar to Ramban. I mean, how does something which is physical, how does it have the capacity to contain and retain something that's spiritual? Well, if you spiritualize yourself, Adam Kiyomus Boel, you negate your physicality. So it's not just abstract. It becomes part of the person. The person has a capacity. He has a depth and a breadth to be able to process and to retain it. Say here, they weren't spiritualized. That intellect, we understand. But what do we feel? We feel pain. We feel demands. There can be consequences. But they're not able to relate to the true value, to the infinite value of Torah, because they don't have the capacity. Because unless you study the Torah, you can't make that evaluation, that you can't relate and to make that evaluation what it is, because you don't have the capacity to relate to what that is. The Gemara tells us in Tainis, it refers to Atzur Min Rabbonan. It's an Aramaic term. A rabbi, a young rabbi, who's adept in his Torah studies, very sharp. So it says that if you see this kind of Torah sage, who's sharp-minded, fully adept in his Torah studies, if you see him becoming angry when he sees something being transgressed, give him the benefit of the doubt. It's not the man has an uncontrollable temper. That's not it. The Rosach Oraisu de Mokar Mischa lay. It's the Torah that's burning within him. It's the Torah. It's not him. Shenemar Hokot Varikeshnu Mashem. The words of Torah like fire. So therefore, as a result of this, given benefit of doubt, it's not him, it's the Torah. So over here, Rashi explains what it means, the Torah. Sheesh lo rochav lev. He has a broadness of heart. Mitoch Torah, as a result of his Torah studies, learning. Umesim lelibo yoser mishar b'nei odom. He's able to process and to be focused and understand more than the average person. Therefore, you have to give benefit of doubt. I'll give an example. A person doesn't even know what it means to eat healthily. And he eats in a way, portion control, quality of food, nourishment-wise. This man is leading into his life that he's gonna live a third of his life, and he's ready to end his life. Everything. Calorie-wise, cholesterol-wise, everything-wise, the most unhealthy diet. And on top of that, he smokes four packs of cigarettes a day, on top of that. And he does no different, because he wasn't raised differently. His whole environment, his circle in society, that's the way they live their life. A person who understands what it means to be responsible, healthily speaking, he sees this. He cringes. this man, this is suicide. And the person who's living the response looks at him and says, what's the problem? He says, you're not satisfied with my menu? It's not, has nothing to do, but you don't realize what you're doing, sir. What am I doing? Don't you realize what are you talking about? He can't even begin relating. But the other person, who has an understanding because he's trained, he has a certain approach to life, and understanding, and he's conditioned to understand what is and what's not. He's internalized the reality of what good health is. The other man doesn't even relate to it. And he can't relate to it. Lahavdil elef avdolos. A person sees a transgression. A person eating non-kosher. A person speaking Lashon Hara. And a person spiritualized. As a result of his Torah study. When he hears Lashon Hara, if you ever read the Chofetz Chaim when he writes, he says, you should be boreach kimino esh. You should flee from Lashon Hara like you're fleeing from fire. You have a raging fire. Fire. I shouldn't have said it. I did the wrong. I shouldn't have spoken. I won't say it again. No. The Chofetz Chaim says, kibareach mino esh. There's a story. Reb Ari Levin, Zechet Tzarek Levroch, who was known as the Tzarek Yerushalayim, came from a small town in Lithuania. The Chofetz Chaim, after he published his work on Lashon Hara, all the laws, he actually would travel from village to village selling his works, his svarim. And he comes into the town, and Reb Ari Levin is sitting and studying in the shul. And the Chofetz Chaim writes in the Mishnah Berurah that in the olden days, they would have tallow candles burning on the omelet. Whenever they would have services, the minyan, they would light candles. And under the candles, they would say, it would say, Shivisi Hashem Lenegdi Somit, it would say Yudke Vavke on a piece of parchment. What happens? If you have the oil and the tallow dripping on, eventually it obliterates the name of God. There's a Torah violation. You're not permitted to obliterate the name of God. So he writes in the Mishnah Berurah that one has to be careful, and therefore you should put a piece of glass over the piece of parchment. So as a result of this, it will preserve, and you will not be in violation of obliterating the name of God through the oil and the parchment coming saturated. Eventually, it will totally become obliterated. He comes into this shul, this base medrash. Reb Ari Levin is studying on a bench in the back, and he sees the omud. And he sees the piece of parchment with Yutke Vovke literally saturated with the fat and with the oil, and it can be obliterated. So the Chofetz Chaim says, you know, to one of the people, he says, you know, you should put a piece of glass, because it's a question. He didn't even introduce to say who he was. And he says to the person, you should put a piece of glass, because you have to be careful, it shouldn't do this, because he'll obliterate the name. So the person who he said it to says, you know, we have a shamus in this shul. He couldn't care. He didn't even finish saying the words. The Chofetz Chaim heard him about to say something negative about the shamus. He screamed like you put a dagger into him. He says, Lashon Hara. He screamed like he was in pain that you can't imagine. And he fled from the shul. So Reb Ari Levin said, when he heard how the Chofetz Chaim screamed Lashon Hara, the tone of voice, for the rest of his life, he was never ever tempted to say something negative about a person. When he saw it firsthand, the way the Chofetz Chaim screamed Lashon Hara, it was like as if you put a knife into him. The pain that he had. What's going on? I said something. I should have been more careful. This is Tzur B'Rabim de Rosach, Rischa Doraisa Rosach Bey. As Rashi explains, he has a depth and a capacity that he sees it for what it is. But why doesn't everybody else see it for what it is? Because the Torah doesn't burn in that person. The Torah is not percolating within that person. As a result of that, you don't even have the tools to process, to understand what's going. It's like a person has a tongue, his taste buds become inoperative. You can eat, taste what's the sweetest thing in the world, or what's bitter. You don't taste the bitterness, you don't taste the sweetness. Because your taste buds are dull. They're not operative. Every Jew What activates the sensitivities of our spirituality, of our neshama? The Torah is all, that's the activator. Without that, you can't activate it. We say every day, at the end of Uvol Letzion, which is right before the Olenu, we say, V'nosan lo Torah Semes, God gave us Torah which is truthful. V'chayol olam nota b'zochenu, He planted eternal life in our midst. Hu yiftach libeinu b'soroso. We're praying, we're supplicating Hashem. He should open our hearts with His Torah. And He should put within our hearts His love and His reverence. What do you mean He should open our hearts with the Torah? Why does the heart have to be opened? What is the heart? The emotion. It's the capacity to be able to process the depth and breadth. This is what we're speaking about. What opens the heart? What gives you that sense of value, positive and negative? Will you want to flee from it like fire? Or you're attracted to it like something which is magnetic. The Torah activates the heart. Hu yiftach libeinu, He opens our heart. What's the key to a Jew's heart? To activate his spirituality. Hu yiftach libeinu b'so raso. It doesn't say hu yiftach libeinu b'Torah. It's b'so raso. If the Torah is studied properly, we study because it's His Torah. It's not intellectualism. We're studying it with what? With a belief, with an understanding. Like the Gemara says, why was the base of Mitzvah destroyed? When they studied Torah, time of the destruction of the first temple, they didn't say Birchas HaTorah. It was intellectualism. It's like people say, you know, I'd like to study Talmud. There's nothing as intellectual as the Talmud. We're not talking about intellect. We're not talking about Torah scholar. We're not talking about scholarship here. We're talking about this is what? It's Lumina Maslasos. We study to understand how to serve God. When are you drawn to God? We're drawn to God through the studies. This is who Yiftach Lev Nisaroso. He opens our heart, our emotion. We're touched. Ava Hashem. What is the motivator? What moves a person? Ava. Therefore, when he opens our heart with his Torah, Yosef Livenu Avoso, then he puts in our Avoso Yoroso, and that's what it's about. The Jews in Egypt didn't have that. Therefore, as a result of not having that, Lushomo Moshe Mikotzer Ruach. They had a limited spirit. They didn't have a broad spirit, a deep spirit. Therefore, they couldn't relate and fully evaluate the infinite value of Moshe was telling them. Until finally, the bondage came to an end, and then they had a capacity, to some degree, to appreciate what Moshe had to offer.